Hi, and welcome to Thursday with a Friend. My name is Lawrence. And today, my very, very, very special guest, Frostbite's G.I. Joe Repro, Lenny. How are you doing today?
I'm great, mate. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for being on. Before we get started, let me just let everyone know this is a premiere. This is pre-recorded. We are recording this in the past so we can talk in the future. But since Lenny is in Australia, he's actually already in the future.
That's right.
Not as far in the future as when this records. Or errors, shall I say. And I guess I love your name. The best Aussie interviewed by Lawrence today. I absolutely love it. So let me ask you, where does your name come from?
So there's a whole bunch of past, but around when I decided I wanted to do a YouTube channel, it comes from my favorite G.I. Joe vehicle is the Snowcat. And I don't know, just the name sort of fit together. Frostbite's a really great character. He just sort of hangs out in the snow, has his cool snow cat, and just does what he wants to do. So yeah, that's just a put together name.
Now, I gotta say, that's one of those things that really shocks me, because when I think of Australia, I think of desert. I think of the Opera House, right? And then the desert. Like, that's what I think. But when I hear Frostbite, you're an Aussie, and it's kind of like, does he know what he's doing? Do they know what this?
I'm originally from North Queensland in Australia, okay. And it was always sweltering hot. So I don't know, like, I think that's why the Snowcat was just so popular with me as a kid, because I'd never seen snow as a kid. So just having this toy that was just, you know, a cool Arctic vehicle is just so cool to me.
I always find that interesting when I talk to people from like Texas, Arizona, California. I'm like, have you ever seen like real snow? Some people be like, well, I go up in the mountains, you know, go snowboarding, skiing, whatever. I'm like, oh, I guess that's real snow. But have you ever been there when it's just the snow is coming down?
Yeah.
And as a kid, you're like, this is awesome. I'm not going to have school tomorrow. And an adult, you're like, just, you got to stop eventually.
Yeah. Right?
Work makes me go. All right. But that's awesome. So your name, is your name Lenny?
I'm a Leonard.
Leonard. Okay. On Facebook, it reads as Leany. L-E-E-Y. Yeah. Is that how it's really spelled and it's pronounced Lenny? I'm asking for myself because I'm always confused when I'm looking at it.
So like during my military service, I did a deployment and they said, you know, might be a good time to just alter your name on Facebook. And so I just changed it a little bit.
All right. So it's not normally spelled that way.
No.
Okay. That was my question, because I've been wondering that for quite some time, because I think of Lenny, I think of, you know, Lenny from the G.I. Joe team. And I see Leany, and sorry if I'm pronouncing that wrong, but I'm like,
no,
have we been saying it wrong? And it's Leany, not Lenny.
It's actually quite common. Some of the Facebook auctioneers that I know really well, like I've known for years, they will, like, I'll bid on something and they will flitter between Leany or Lenny. And some of them will, you know, start angrily correcting themselves online. So yeah, it's quite funny to watch.
That's awesome. That is absolutely awesome. So do you mind me asking about what your age is?
Yeah, so I'm 47.
Okay. I've come to that point where you don't always want to ask, because you talk to women so much they don't want to tell you the name. Not saying you're female-like. But so you're in the same age range as me, but you live across the pond. So where were you born at?
I come from Bundaberg in Queensland.
Which is Australia, correct? correct?
Yeah, that's sort of, it's sort of just southeast, but of Queensland, in Queensland. So if you look at all of Australia's east coast, it's about halfway.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So growing up, you're born. Do you have any siblings that you had as built-in play friends or?
No. So I've got three older sisters and two of them were so older, you know, they'd already moved out of the house. So yeah, it was just sort of me and school friends.
Okay. And so as growing up, do you remember like the first like toys that you had? I'm always interested when there's anyone from, especially across the pond. I love saying, I don't know why I love saying, across the pond. It's an ocean. It's not even close to being a pond. I always find, because I, when I had, our usual mic on and when I had, the one shark dude, shark.
Avril Lavigne, I think.
Avril Lavigne, that's right.
Yeah.
Avril Howe, right? Howe's. I'm always interested to hear that, like, everything was way different. And we'll get into that a little in a little bit. But what were, like, the first toys that you remember as a child just playing with?
The first, absolute first toys that I remember playing with were actually Arco the Otherworld and Sky Command Commanders.
Okay. Can you elaborate on what Orc? I hear Orco, I automatically. Or Orca.
Okay. No. It's Arco, so it's A-R-C-O.
Okay.
And that's the brand. And then the toy was called The Other World.
All right.
It's a really well-known toy. And it's, you'd know because they're really gummy-looking figures, and they have the little double-prong holes in their arms and legs so that you can bend them.
How is it spelled?
Arco, A-R-C-O.
Arco Toys?
Yeah, Arco the Other World.
The Other World.
Mm.
Oh, okay. Oh, all right. That is interesting. I don't think I've ever seen these.
Yeah, they were, I'd actually forgotten about them until I got back into the toy community. And
I don't think I've ever done this. But I'm going to present this really quick because people are like, why don't you just show it? I don't like doing editing. So so quickly, this is what we are talking about. And very interesting because I don't remember these at all.
Yeah.
But so you might have been what, like 4, 5 remembering this?
I think I would have been, 4 or 5.
Oh, that's most Master of the Universe.
Yeah.
Wow, that is a little comic on the back.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
They're really, really nice toys.
Wow.
It's a massive double-headed dragon mount, and it's got the, you know, the seat on it, and the guy rides it, and these reins and everything, and yeah, just so nice.
We can see your face light up when you think about it, because
I remember just nice toys, you know. Like when you're 47 now, and you played with these things when you were 4, and they were beautiful when they were released then. It's just amazing.
Mm. Yeah, I remember. Like, I mean, I still have my Lone Ranger and Tonto.
Mm.
I remember having, you know, Silver, and I don't remember what Tonto's horse's name was, but having those and just playing around with them, and you know, those aren't even expensive, which I was kind of hoping they would be because I still have mine. So you said this, and what was the other things that you remember?
The other one I remember. So Arco was definitely the first toys I remember, and then I remember having a line called Sky Commanders. I don't know. Do you know Sky Commanders?
I do. I think so. I'm gonna pull it up really. That sounds familiar.
Yeah, they were sort of kind of mask size figures, and they came with yeah, like ropes and strings and stuff, and you could glide them through the air.
Oh yeah, it was okay. It was a cartoon, Hanna-Barbera.
Mm.
Probably hit images, but it'd be a lot easier. You can see how archaic I am with all this still. Okay, yeah. Now this actually seems familiar to me.
Mm.
Especially, that's the Sky Commanders, right?
Yeah, yeah.
This one does for sure. So, okay. So that was like the first thing that you remember actually playing around with. And
yeah.
Now, as you started to get a little bit older, was there a line that you just, as a kid, just fell in love with?
Yeah, that's, you know, easily G.I. Joe and Transformers.
Okay.
Just those two.
And it was G.I. Joe where you were at, correct?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Because Action Force, see, I was always under the impression that Action Force was like everyone outside of the U.S. and Canada.
Mm.
But I think when I had the Dolphin dude, Admiral Levine fan.
Oh, yeah, that guy. Yeah,
yeah, he was explaining it. And I think Usual Mike also did. And I was really shocked over that because I just always assumed that everyone was always Action Force. I didn't assume that till later on because I didn't know what Action Force was.
Yeah.
Because obviously no internet when we're in the early 80s. There was no Google. There was no doing this, all right? So G.I. Joe and Transformers, those were the two that you remember? And that would have been, you know, again, you're just a year younger than me, so 82, 83.
Yeah.
Now, did you get them around the same time that we did?
I think so. Okay. You know, like when you're a kid, you're not sort of time dating things. Yeah.
But you also grow out of toys usually fairly, like, you usually know around the age that you kind of grow out of toys.
Yeah.
Usually right around 12, 13, that teenage year where you're like, I don't play with toys. I don't play, even though, you know, even though now you look back and you realize every kid was playing with toys at that age. And you guys were all so stupid. You were saying you didn't. Everyone was now just playing with their toys at home by themselves because they didn't want to admit it. So G.I. Joe Transformers, is there any reason why for those two lines that you gravitated to?
I think they were just the coolest toys available. Like, I do remember Leonard the Core getting sold next to the G.I. Joes. And I do remember, even as a kid, just looking at those Leonard the Core and just thinking, like, who made those? Like, they're no good.
And your parents would say, you could get two of... No, I can't. No, no. I want any of those figures over here.
They were, like, my parents were a bit different, as in I generally would ask and they would just, you know, most of the time say no, but then, you know, later on they'd just bring me that, you know. It was like, you know, the life lesson of don't keep asking for stuff and you might get something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what... Of both those lines,
did
you ever have like a favorite character or a favorite couple characters that you always had to have? Like, no matter what, like you were gravitating towards those.
For memory wise, for G.I. Joe, like I seem to remember having Tomax and Zamot as, you know, I think they might have been the first ones I had. But I always, you know, Hit and Run, Shockwave, and Low Light would probably be the top three for me, for Joe's.
Okay.
And then I did get Metroplex from Transformers as a kid, which, you know, when you're older, you realize how epic that present actually was.
Yep.
But I think Beachcomber and Springer from Transformers would be the ones.
I definitely remember the Metroplex where it's like it was this giant Transformer.
Yeah.
Which in actuality, it wasn't that much bigger than the other ones for how big it was supposed to be. Like, this thing is supposed to be a city, and he's like three times the size of Optimus Prime, which is big, but not for a whole city.
Well, I think the measurement could be 1.5 Costco hot dogs high.
So you obviously have Costco's there.
Yeah.
And so you had Metroplex?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So you clearly, your parents were willing to buy you some expensive stuff. Because you talked to a lot of people that didn't have very much and they got GoBots instead of the Transformers. Which, nothing wrong with GoBots because some of them are a lot of fun. I still stand by that. I still think Psycho is a great figure.
GoBots were still fantastic, I reckon.
Yeah.
Some of them were great.
I love Leader One. Don't get me wrong, Psycho being as big as Leader One didn't make any sense because one was a fighter jet and one was motorcycle. But at the same time, we watched Megatron turn into a gun that anyone could fire.
Yeah.
Anyone could fire. Did you have Optimus Prime, Megatron?
No. No, they, like, even getting Metroplex, that was my one and only birthday present 1 year.
Okay.
So it was and I remember my parents asking, do you like this Jetfire thing or do you like the Metroplex?
And you went with Metroplex?
Yeah.
So I love Jetfire, but I always loved Robotech.
Yeah.
So when you saw Jetfire, I had a friend that had it. You always try changing into that half robot, half plane.
Yeah.
Where the legs are just kind of hanging out and the arms are hanging out. But as you get older, you realize the actual story behind all that. And you're like, oh, this really was created after this. So, so you started to get a little bit older. Did you get in any other toy lines? Because you're a year younger than me, so you may have actually been there when the Turtles, I was crossing paths with Turtles.
So, interestingly, my parents used to travel sometimes, and they came back from, I think, the UK, and they bought me, the very first Leonardo. And they said it wasn't due for release yet in Australia. So they'd picked it up overseas. So they were, I don't know if it was bull crap or not, but they were basically saying, you may have the first Leonardo in the country.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
They probably stopped on the way home from the airport and picked it up.
Possibly. It sounded good though.
But it's the story that counts, right? It's all about the story.
I still remember it.
They're like, that looks new. Let's just grab it. We'll say it's like the first one. And when we go there, we'll be like, oh my God, they just showed up.
But that, getting Ninja Turtles at the time, like I hadn't seen any media, like no comics or cartoons. They just gave me this and said, oh, it's a turtle called Leonardo and it's got ninja weapons and stuff. And I was like, okay, sure.
I first saw the comic. It was in, I believe, ninth grade. No, it was eighth grade because I was still in middle school. And it was the black and white comic where they all had the red bands. And I guess it wasn't all black and white, but. And I had no idea. Like, I didn't know what it was. I thought it looked really cool because they looked very menacing. They didn't look, they weren't the cartoony ones that we got for quite some time. I always thought they were super cool looking. And there was a guy that I sat at a table with. I wouldn't call him a friend because I don't even remember who he was. But he was, a comic guy, right?
Yeah.
Nothing against him, all right? Nothing against him if he's watching and remembers Home Economics. I remember where Home Economics. This was crazy. And him showing it to me, and it was just like, wow, that looks actually pretty cool. But you're at that age where it's like, I can't admit I like toys.
Yeah.
Especially, eighth grade. And I was always G.I. Joe. So you told me earlier you have some MOTU figures there, Master of the Universe.
Yeah.
Did you get into any Master He-Man? I always call it He-Man. I didn't even know it was called Master of the Universe till I was an adult. I always thought it was He-Man.
The memories just aren't that prominent for Motu. Like, I remember having Dragon Blaster Skelly, and I think I had Cyclone.
Okay.
But I do remember it from my childhood. They're just not as strong as G.I. Joe or Transformers.
Yeah, I was talking to someone, and I'm like, God, I'm like, I don't even remember what, like, I don't even remember having figures when we started talking about it, because I always go over a friend's house, and he had all the Motu stuff.
Yeah.
And then after I got done, I started thinking, oh, wait, I had Mechaneck, I had Buzz Off, I had Stratos, I had Cobra. Like, I remembered all the figures. I never had vehicles. We'd go over his house, but like, that's where I always play with them. And he had everything, so I don't even remember ever, like, taking the toys over there.
I remember, like, my parents had bought me a Battle Ram, and that was – I just remember that vehicle just being so fantastic. You know, the front coming away as a sky sled, and you sit there and shoot the little cannon off.
That thing had, especially for a kid, you didn't have to, like, cram a figure into it, like the Sky Striker. You didn't have to get the back peg all right.
No.
You just sat right on it. You put his hands on it, and then you disconnected it.
Yeah.
And didn't it come with, like, three...
Yeah,
you didn't call them rockets because they were flat, right? Weren't they, like, flat with the design on it? Yeah. So not even rockets; they're like flying battering rams.
Yeah, that's it's just typical of that beautiful artwork back in the day. It's just some weirdly sad skull face with horns that's gonna smash through your Castle Grayskull.
Oh man. See, that's fun. That is fun for kids. So as you started to get a little bit older, did you always collect toys? Did it turn into, I know a lot of people, they say they went from toys to comics because it's something you can hide easier. Yeah. And I think if you are caught collecting comics or reading comics, you say, hey, I'm just reading, right? Or did you always collect toys or play with toys?
So from about age 14, I started collecting comics, and I was red hot on the X-Men.
Okay.
So I remember, like, my grail piece is Uncanny X-Men 266, first appearance Gambit.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And that's, like, I just love... I love, love, love just that era of artwork and you know, what the heroes represented
Okay. So you get into comics. Now, did you get rid of your toys or did your parents keep them for you or?
I I've mentioned this several times in my videos. I kept my toys up until about age 23. And then I was with my missus at the time, but it was more just, you know, you're getting on the booze with your mates and what do you need these toys for? Oh, wait, they're money. What's this thing called eBay? Sweet. So sold pretty much everything. Like that Leonardo that I was talking about, that's the only thing that's actually saved from my childhood because I forgot that it was sitting in my parents' house.
Wow. So you hit that eBay hard.
Yeah. Yeah. I sold a Transformers collector's case and it had all of my original figures in it. And I remember selling my Joes and I sold my Joe comic collection as well to some guy. I think he was in the States, and that was something like 50 comics. So, yeah. It's horrifying to hear, I know.
Hey, I often mention I had a bunch of Motu. I had a bunch of Transformers. I had GoBots. I had Thundercats. I have no idea what I did with them. G.I. Joe was the only thing that I kept. That was the one thing I remember telling my dad. G.I. Joe was the one thing I have to keep. And I can't imagine my dad selling any of this stuff. So, but I don't remember selling it. But I know it's not in my possession. And as far as I'm concerned, it has not transferred from the house that I grew up to where my dad lives now. Right. With that said, him and his wife, they have so much stuff in that house that there could be some stuff. They were, because her husband passed away. They knew each other. My mom had passed away, but passed away well before that. They just ended up together. Last year, my dad was saying they had to get some work done on the roof. And they had to go up into this crawl space that no one had ever been in since her husband had passed away, which they've been together over 20 years, I think.
Yeah.
He said, we get upstairs, there's five or six big model airplanes put together. And my dad's like, there's no way to get them down because they won't fit up there, which meant her husband had to have gone up there, put them together while up there. And it's a small crawl space. And my dad was like, when we die, if we ever move, like, people get airplanes. They get airplanes with them. So as you got into high school, it is called high school in Australia, right?
Yeah.
Did you get in any sports or anything like that? You said you got into comics, but.
I was doing volleyball when I was 16.
Okay. That was not on the bingo card today.
I am.
Volleyball.
Because I'm like, a tall guy. Like, so I was playing. I'm 6'5".
Oh, wow. Okay.
So I was playing in A grade men's volleyball when I was 16.
Oh, all right. Yeah, like I said, that was not on the bingo card today.
No, it's not the usual.
So if anyone has, what sports did he get into? Volleyball.
Volleyball.
You may have won bingo.
And not just comics as well. Like, I was doing a lot of trading cards.
Okay. What type? Because
that 94 was the prime time for the Fleer Ultra, Spider-Man, and X-Men. Like, the sets coming out in 94 were just magic.
Okay. No sports, though. No sports cards.
There were basketball cards at the time, but they were just so hard to get. And I don't know, I just wasn't really into basketball at the time. But the pop culture was starting to hit us a lot more. And it's different for people in different parts of Australia, because I was in sort of a redneck town called Mackay. So we didn't have a lot of, like, we had two TV channels, I think. So the pop culture was very much lost on us. So, you know, things like Jordan and The Simpsons and, you know, all these mainstream things, we didn't get them straight away.
All right. So after you graduate, you're playing volleyball through high school.
Yep.
And is it semi-pro league or is it a?
It was just like the town league.
Okay.
Yeah.
So after you graduate, did you go on to university, right? It's called university for you guys?
No. Uni for us.
Uni. Okay.
Yeah.
Ted didn't realize that Ken from Toy Connections, who I had on a couple weeks ago, if I remember correctly, he didn't realize, like, we call it like a university, like we call it college.
Yeah.
Everyone in Canada calls it university. I mean, it is like the you know, University of Michigan, or U of M, or Michigan State University, but we still call it, you go to college. Their college is what they're, I believe they only consider, like, their community college. Like, we consider it all college, even if it's a university or community. But I found out over time, everyone else seems to call it university. It just seems weird, but I think you know how we are in America. We think the world revolves around us because we have 11 aircraft carrier, and
That's why I had to chuck out the 1.5 Costco dog measurement
thing. Have you been to the US?
Yeah, I've been to Baltimore, DC, Virginia Beach, been to Hawaii a couple of times, been to American Samoa, Guam. I think that's it. Yeah.
Okay.
So, and LA, sorry.
Oh, LA.
Anaheim, yeah.
Now, was this, well, we'll get to that in a little bit. So you graduate, so you went on to uni.
Oh, I didn't. I got like absolutely horrible scores in high school. And then my parents got me to repeat a year. And then I got slightly less horrible scores.
All right, so grades are considered scores there.
Oh no, yeah, sorry, because it's the final year of year 12. You get a score for how well you did for the final test.
Like 4.0, 3.0.
Yeah, something like that.
All right.
Yeah,
like I find this stuff interesting because, I mean, I'm sure I could all find. I look at Roman in the back here, looking for this. I always find this stuff interesting, even though you can go on the internet and you can find out. It's when you're talking to somebody and you're like, we all have the same things for the most part.
Yeah.
But how we have different languages. And it really does feel like most people know from, I'm assuming because of how the US is and TV, that most people know how we talk.
Yeah.
But it's when we start to hear other people's. Because I remember when I was on with you and you had the 10 things that you wanted me, which I love that. I don't really do that with people. That was awesome. And I got most of them right. I think I got most of them like in the ballpark.
Yeah.
All right. So you didn't go on to uni because you said your grades were, I'm sorry, your scores were, they made
not
it
good.
Across.
They're average. Actually, below average. Yeah.
So what did you do after you graduated from high school?
So I joined the military.
All right. And how long did you serve in the military?
So last year I completed 27 years.
That's a long time.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not like a three-year tour. That's a long time.
It feels like it.
I would say so. Yeah. So you just retired last year.
Yeah, from the military. Okay. I got to a point that, I wasn't enjoying it as much, and I was not liking the way that my trade was going in the future. So I did what I thought was the most responsible thing and removed myself from the situation.
Okay. But you said around 23, you sold off all your toys.
Yeah.
You're drinking.
Yeah.
So I've never served in any military, so I don't know exactly. I mean, I know obviously you get housed at specific spots and a lot of people are constantly bouncing around. But how do you go about that? I mean, are you living a regular life just while serving?
Like the military here will move you and they'll put you in one of their defense houses. And, when you move, everything gets packed up. And you just generally go where you're told to go and do what you're told to do.
So you move your family wherever you need to go.
Yeah. Yep. Like,
so were you in, when you got rid of your toys, were you in the area where your family, like where your parents were, or was that
towards the later? So, 5 or 6 years ago, I got posted to an area that was the closest I'd ever been to my parents and family. And that was a 5-hour drive away.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So your toys ended up following you around rather than.
Initial period.
Okay. So 23. You sell your stuff.
Hmm.
You talked about, I'm assuming, now, when did you meet? You're married, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. When did you, like, what age, when did you meet your wife?
I met her when I was, I'm going to say 21.
Okay. So, yeah. So you sell your toys so you can take her out on some dates that involve drinking. How was she when you know, when she realized you had toys, or did she just assume that, oh, those were just from his childhood or something that he has?
Because like at the time I was doing, you know, I had a lot of other nerd interests. So I think I was smashing Final Fantasy VII on the PlayStation 1. you know, I'd be watching a lot of nerdy related shows, and comics for me is a big thing. I've always kept my comics.
Okay.
Except for the Joe one. You know, it's great. I'm a Joe guy and I sold all that shit. But yeah, so she already knew that I was way too far down the nerd rabbit hole. So yeah.
So she realized there was no saving you.
Yeah. And in fact, like probably one of the funniest things I can share with you is my friends knew that I was a nerd. Like I had every version of the Game Boy. I've played every version of Pokemon back in those late 90s. And the thing that used to shit my friends to no avail was I would go over to one of their places. They'd be watching the big AFL grand final, and they get right into it and everything's real manly, and I would be sitting there playing Pokemon on my Game Boy whilst having drinks with them, because I don't like that football, and I would only do it because it was shitting them to tears.
So you were trolling your friends at their own get together.
Yes.
I love that.
That's military.
That is awesome. So
that really annoys you. Well, I won't do that again.
I don't know what you mean by that. I would never do something like that. If a friend of mine told me something annoyed them, I would never do that again. I'm so polite. I was like, I fully respect.
Yep.
I can't even say
that's right, that. Avril. That's right.
That's right, Avril. You go, Avril.
Yeah.
my buddy that was he was a sailor. And he I kind of mentioned it before. He did missions with like the Navy SEALs and stuff. He wasn't a SEAL. He made that clear to me, but he did special forces with them. He talked about being on a sub for a while. And he said, that's the place you don't want to, like, so as soon as they find out something bothers you, they're going to pick at you. So you just, you don't let anything bother you.
Never reveal your weakness.
Yeah. And he said there's this one guy, he did it. And they kept picking on him until he finally told the XO. So they got in trouble. And he said, they grabbed him, and you got a sub, right? There's not much room. They said they tied his hands behind his legs, or his hands behind his back and his feet together, and put him in the back of the sub. And he said, once that thing started rocking, he had nothing to protect himself. They said he fell straight down, shattered his nose. Now you're gonna, you're in a sub, you can't do nothing. To make a point to him.
Yeah.
And he goes, I remember them looking at me and they're like, you got any issues? He's like, nope, not at all. And he said, that guy never said another word about it.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, you can't do nothing, right? You'd have to do something really awful to be, you know, put in quarters in a submarine. They can't just come up and say, hey, helicopter, come get them.
Well, usually, you know, like military is all conformity, right? Like if you're not part of a team, who are you?
Yeah.
So it was generally a thing of, like, generally discipline wasn't needed to be enforced because the team would enforce the discipline.
But they hated it. I'm playing Pokemon.
And that's what That was my little rebellion of I'm here to have drinks with you guys, but I'm not interested in that. Thank you.
And you know, the sad thing is today you go to a get together and everyone's on their phone anyway. Mm. I mean, which is the same thing as being on a Game Boy, except it's a little bit bigger. Especially if you had the one that I had, which was the black and white one. Especially your whole hand is like.
Oh yeah. They weren't great, you know, weren't great. It's probably why you have arthritis and stuff as an old person from the Game Boy.
Mm. And I'm tiny, but I could play Tetris like amazing on that. But if you put me on the Nintendo when it was in color, it threw me off.
Yeah.
And one of my best friends, a guy I still skateboard with today, he was the exact opposite. He could get on the Nintendo and play it. But if you got on the Game Boy, I think the black and white just, because it's the same game. I think the black and white just completely threw him off. Or maybe because it was a smaller screen, but I mean, the guy's so smart and accomplished at everything he does. But I just remember I would get on that and I'd watch people that I was better than them on what they were doing on the Nintendo on my Game Boy. But man, you put me on that thing and I wasn't even coming close to what they were doing. And I think the colors really just totally messed with me.
It's a brain function thing.
Yeah. Mm. But man, they looked at the black and white and they're like, how do you look at this? I'm like, what are you talking about? Yeah. They're just lines. So do you mind me asking what you did in the military? Because usually you get given a job. If you can't, then that's perfectly fine. I understand. Mm.
I'd probably just skip on that.
No problem at all.
Yeah,
I
was in the Air Force though.
Okay, all right. So you served in the Air Force. So serving that long, what is it that you're doing on your free time, and how do you go about that? Because when I talk to people, hey, I did this for 3 years and then I moved on to this. You're doing, I'm not going to say one job. You probably did multiple jobs, but you were in the same, under the same umbrella of doing stuff. And obviously when people get deployed or whatever, I can't imagine you're doing too much other than serving for your country. So what exactly, how did you get back into toy collecting?
So getting back into toy collecting was about 3 years ago now. Like, my father died and I went out for his funeral and I come back and I just recently had a shoulder surgery. Thank you, military service. and during that time, cause it's, you know, 4 or 5 months or something of, getting back to normal from that. I gave up World of Warcraft after playing that for 16 years, I think it was, or 15 years.
So, you know, hold on. Let me go back before the toys. So you were really into games. Like, were you collecting games?
I wasn't collecting games. I was just enjoying them.
Okay.
I played the Final Fantasy series up to, I think, 10X.
All right.
If anyone's a player and they know that. And then I was sort of just, you know, the Game Boys, they were a massive part of my life just because you could take them anywhere and enjoy them.
So I'm saying you had Game Boy, then you had Game Boy Color.
Yeah, I had everything. I would literally buy one, play it until the next one come out, and then sell that one. And then buy this one. And I just went through the entire series of Game Boys. Yeah.
So I would assume you probably have a Nintendo Switch.
Yeah.
Essentially, it is a Game Boy.
Yes, it is.
Console.
Yeah.
All right. So during, before we get into the whole toy thing.
Yeah.
You and your wife, did you guys have children?
Yeah, we've got two daughters.
Okay. So do you share any, like, did you share, like, playing video games, or are they just, I don't care about that, and dad's in
one of them? doesn't care, and one of them deeply cares about gaming.
Sounds like you deeply worry about that.
It's fine. She doesn't. The good thing about her is, like, we've raised both of our daughters, you know, to try different things. Like we always said as they were growing up, you've got to try each type of food once. And if you don't like it, you don't have to have it again. And it's just experiences like that. Like, you know, you should go and try this sport, or you should try this game, or, and if you don't like things, you don't have to do them again. So that's how our daughters are. Like, my gaming daughter, I can say to her, hey bro, just try this game for an hour, because I love it. And if you don't like it, it's all good.
You're an enabler. Well, that's what you are.
Enabler, or, you know, presenting opportunities.
See, when we had a boy, I thought, great, he'll love skateboarding just because I do.
Yeah.
I'm never gonna make my kids do anything. Neither kid loves skateboarding, but my whole thinking was, I'm gonna have kids. They're gonna love skateboarding because I do, and then I can use them to go to the park, the skate park. Yeah. You know, so when I'd be like, "Hey, I'm going to the park. I'm taking the kids to the park." You mean the skate park? Hey, it's a park.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, my kids never really cared for it nearly as much as I did, and I was never gonna push them. All I did, just like you, I want you to try it. I want you to try something different. Yeah. You know, until you get to know what you know what you want to do. And I can say my ex's boyfriend, not boyfriend, sometimes boyfriend, friend, I don't know what he really is. He made mention last year about how Olivia should start golfing, because there's all these golf scholarships for females that don't get used. She's never shown an interest in it. Never cared, but they presented it to her. They said it, and I was like, "Do you want to do it?" And she's like, I'm not really sure." I'm like, "Well, if you don't want to do it, you need, because I think golf is awful. Like, I don't like watching it. I don't like anything about it. If it makes her happy, great." Mm-hmm. And she did a year of it. She's very athletically gifted with anything.
Yeah,
not that you need to be athletically gifted to golf. The ball just sits there and you hit it. It takes talent. Before anyone yells at me, it does take talent, but you need to be athletic. And at the end of the year, I talked to her and I said, "Do you like it?" She said, I really like it. Okay. She said, "I don't like watching it. I don't think I could ever sit down and watch it, Dad. But like, you put a skate video on, I'm going to stop and I'm going to sit there, and people are going to be like, hey, Lawrence, we're over here," and be like, but you see, look at that. You know, so I'm, you know, we're like you. Now, I don't, you know, we didn't say you got to try everything, but I was never going to try and discourage my kids from doing anything. But I did want to encourage them to do more. Like, my dad was always like, I remember him saying, he goes, "I don't care that you love skateboarding and that's what you want to do. I just wish you would have tried more stuff." Now, my dad wasn't into sports, so there was no like bonding over like going to baseball games or football games.
Yeah. Right?
And all I wanted to do was skateboard. And it drove him nuts because he wanted me to try other things, but at the same time, I never had someone like to sit down and watch sports with, because he never cared. He still doesn't care. Yeah, I think he likes baseball, but he doesn't really care. You know, where me, I was like, I want to skateboard, and that's it. So,
well, that's good that he didn't turn around and say, "I hate skateboarding, so you're never skateboarding" as well.
Oh yeah, and he was he was always supportive of it. I mean.
Yeah,
he kind of looked. I mean, he saw me fall. It was a couple of years ago on video, and he was like, "You okay?" I'm like, "That was nothing." probably wasn't the best thing to tell your dad, you know, when you're like 45 years old. That slam was nothing. He's probably going, you know, you may not. So you have a gaming daughter and then a non-gaming daughter. Now, do you actually game with the gaming daughter?
I don't game a lot because of the whole World of Warcraft thing. Like, I could see that it's, you know, I like to game and play, and it's, I don't know, like, I get too immersed in it. I'm definitely not a raider. If anyone plays World of Warcraft, they know there's two types of WoWers. which is social players and raiders. And I was a social player. So, but I just enjoyed it. So now, now things are different, and I stopped Warcraft and took up 3D printing. So it's replacing one with the other. Yeah.
We're going to get to that soon. Now, what about so your non-gaming daughter?
She loves makeup and, looking nice and looking pretty and, yeah.
My daughter, she still is a tomboy, but
yeah,
we definitely saw that. Now, we went through, my ex's daughter, who I raised for 15 years.
Hmm.
She was, she's an introvert. She didn't have a lot of friends, and she would rather go downstairs. And she would do makeup and photography. So not like makeup like Olivia. Mm. Well, Olivia does that too. Like, she'd do clown makeup. She did all kinds of stuff. And then my son is a major introvert. Doesn't really leave. Doesn't plays games. Graduated. Doesn't have a lot of friends where he goes out and does stuff with. So those are the two oldest.
Yeah.
And my ex is like, Olivia's making up for it. It would have been nice to have like an introvert, one that was maybe introverted but still went out. No, we had introvert, more introverted, and now we have the one that has to be the center of attention. She wants to be at every game, and I love it. But I was like, we didn't even get prepared. Like, we were going the opposite way. So I do know about that to a point.
We do. We sit down and play the Switch occasionally all together, and we play. You know, it'll be Mario Kart or Mario Party, and I do the glorious dad thing of whooping my gaming daughter's ass on the first race in Mario Kart, and then sitting back on my laurels after that while she whoops me.
What you have to do is remember this. After you win, you tell her that you're the champion and you're retiring as the champion. So even if she wins, it's just an exhibition and it doesn't really count.
Hey, it doesn't matter because I've already won. I showed you I'm the best.
Well, I'm glad that's not just a United States thing, not just an American thing.
It's a father thing.
I absolutely love that. And then your wife. So she's fully on board and okay with when you were big into gaming and obviously now what you're turned your, because I think once you're a collector, of some sort.
Yeah.
You're always collecting something. And sometimes you may repress that, but it's always going to come out in some way, fashion or form. And your wife is perfectly fine with that. And
yeah. So I, like I've told her before, the reason I don't go nuts with collecting is I use this office and the house type thing. Like, we don't have toys everywhere. I think I have, I've got four cabinets in total, and I don't buy any more. So if I can't fit it in to the cabinets, then I just don't buy stuff.
Wow.
So things like vehicles, G.I. Joe vehicles, I have probably about five snow cats stowed away. I have, two devil fishes, a couple of outpost defenders, and that's it. I don't have any big vehicles.
You have an outpost defender, but you have nothing over the speed bump other than the snow cat.
You're thinking of the guard post.
Oh, okay.
Outpost defenders, the sandbags with the 50 cal.
I'm sorry. Sorry, guys. I don't know my G.I. Joe. I know someone's going to yell at me.
That's
okay. Not you. Somebody will yell at me going, you don't even know anything.
That's okay.
All right. So let's move along. You said about 3 years ago, you got back into toy collecting.
Yeah, so my father passed away And, you know, had just finished, I was recuperating from my shoulder surgery. I'd finished Warcraft. And when I got back from the funeral, you know, how your brain, you're 40, in your 40s and your brain just ticks over. And I was like, and I bought some stuff back from my parents' house. And I, you know, sitting here and I was like, and I wasn't doing 3D printing at this point. I was just in this weird period. And I was like, oh, what about those toys I used to have? And I didn't actually know at that point that you, that there were groups on Facebook, that if you like something, you could find groups. So I found the Australian G.I. Joe collectors group and I joined it and I was like, oh man, these are the, this is the stuff I used to have. And then I bought an Outpost Defender and it didn't have an aerial. And I looked on eBay and it was going to cost me, I think it was $60 Australian to buy it and get it shipped from America. And I thought that's bull crap. You know, like this is a small bit of plastic. And I thought to myself, man, I've been listening to people talking about 3D printing recently. So I got onto Gumtree, which is like our Craigslist.
Okay.
And there was a guy close to me selling a 3D printer. So I messaged him and he said, yep, come on over. And I went over there and he was a uni student and he was upgrading and he had this base level machine. And he wasn't doing anything. I was there for 2 hours. He explained how to use it. He leveled it all for me, made sure it was perfect. And I come home, found the plan for the Outpost Defender antenna, and I printed that sucker.
All right.
It's probably, you know, the shittest but most epic print I've ever done because it was my first ever. but from there, you know, like I started getting really good at it. I self-taught myself watching YouTube videos. And there's a guy on YouTube that I really respect called Frankly Built.
Okay.
And he is ex Air Force, US Air Force, I think.
Okay.
And he basically, he makes like Iron Man suits for himself, like full ones that he can do that. And the lights light up and helmet lifts up and he's amazing. And he is now out of the Air Force and is, you know, on speaking tours and a whole bunch of stuff. He's amazing. But yeah, so I taught myself how to do it and then I taught myself how to design stuff and yeah, I've just been progressing ever since.
Now that's interesting that you learn how to design stuff.
Yeah.
So, all right. So you get into 3D printing.
Mm.
Now, what are you collecting at this time?
So I was literally just getting back into Joe's.
Okay.
And I started from nothing with Joe's. Like I didn't have any G.I. Joe's. So I got an Outpost Defender and I think I would have picked up like a low light and a Shockwave.
All right.
And this was just before COVID.
Okay.
Around COVID. So prices were insane.
Yep. Yeah, they had shot up. So now your Frostbite G.I. Joe Repro.
Yeah.
Does that mean you are printing reproduction weapons and backpacks and different things like that?
Yes.
Okay. I that's what I kind of assumed.
Yeah.
I didn't know if you were, because I didn't know you 3D printed.
Yeah.
I didn't know if you just were, you know, cleaning them up, completing them, and then reselling them.
No. I've always said to people, you know, you can buy one of my things and you can do two things with it. You can, if you're like me and you don't care if you got the original parts, this can just be your part that you'll look at. Or if you do care if you got the original part, you can just get one of my parts, which I sell for, you know, $5 to $8 Australian. So probably, you know, $3.50 American. And it can be a placeholder for when you find the original part.
Yeah, and I know I have 3D printed stuff, and it's on a very basic level. But I know for like the ferret, of course I brought it, I had it up here, and I already took it downstairs. I reprinted certain things, but it's mine. It's my childhood one.
That's right.
And I'm not looking to sell it. I also sold a, I reprinted the seats and all the missiles for the Sky Striker. Yeah. I had a shell of one, and I sold it for a good amount of money, but I let them know, hey, these are 3D printed missiles. I actually have the 3D printed missiles on it because they're this nice dark black.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like, you know what, if one breaks, I'd rather not break one of the original ones.
That's
I'll just
right.
Stash them because it's for my own, you know, it's for my own. And I, you know, my collection is not a complete collection. I don't even have a stun that. Well, I think I might have a stun that's close to being complete, but I have a lot of things that are like, it's good enough.
That's right.
It's good enough. It's more than a shell, but it's not complete. But like for like the Mauler that I have, it's missing two mud flaps in the back. I wouldn't want to put 3D printed mud flaps on it just because it's so close to being complete and worth so much money.
So to give you an example. So another beautiful toy from the childhood, the wolf. That's original.
Okay.
That's my design and print.
All right. Now, doesn't it bother you that the two different colors?
Oh, no, I just, it's just a nice reminder to me of what I can do.
See, I would print up both and put the 3D printed ones on it. Like that's how my mind would work.
So that's my design as well.
Okay. I mean, it looks really good.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, I've done these on a whim and just because I needed them, and I can paint them anytime I like. I just haven't. But yeah.
That went down wrong. So, do you sell stuff to the U.S. also, or is it just basically out of Australia?
I generally try not to ship in internationally.
Okay.
Only because I'm selling my parts so cheap that the postage is going to be, you know, $15, $20,
$25. Yeah.
And then if it goes missing, like through eBay, I have to sort that out.
Okay.
So if I sell some, like someone wanted one of my low light bipods once, and I sell them for $5. So if I sell that for $5 and it goes missing, and then I have to follow up with the American Postal System for, you know, $5 minus the 14% that eBay takes.
And by that time, they could have just gone and probably, even though they're going to pay more, even though they're going to pay more for a real bipod, it's going to probably cost around the same in the U.S.
Like, I'm not the only guy designing stuff. Like, there's a whole community of G.I. Joe 3D printing people.
Yeah.
So, you know, like, there's heaps of people in the States that could do this stuff.
Yeah.
I get, like, a weird number of people from America and South America contacting me saying, hey bro, can you ship your parts? And I just feel like saying, there's people you have that can do that for you.
Yeah, but if they like what you're doing, but I fully understand.
Difficult,
especially if you're someone you don't know. I think it might be different if it's someone you knew that reached
out
and you're like, hey, if it gets lost, it's on me. I understand that.
Yeah, that's right.
Where last thing you need is someone who's sitting with it in hand going, I never received it.
Yeah.
I made that mistake.
Like if anyone in our community, like people that I'm talking to and chatting to all the time, damn right, if you need stuff, just let me know.
Yeah.
But if it's just Joe Blow off the street, well, I'm sorry, I'm just going to have to skip.
Yeah, because that few dollars, it sounds like, really isn't worth it for the hassle.
It's not.
I sense...
I do really feel bad, like, because I've done... There's heaps of guys here that had hammers. Do you know the hammer?
War hammer? Oh.
No, the...
Oh, my God. I have, like, two shells of that.
So there's heaps of guys here that have, you know, a complete hammer but don't have the aerial.
Yeah.
So through a very, inflated process, I made the aerial for it, and it's perfect. And people here are happy. And then now I have people from the States contacting me going, bro, can you ship that? And I'm like, well, that's 15 Australian dollars. I'm sorry, I can't, because I just don't want to have to deal with any problems.
No, but I fully understand that. I tell my buddy... Yeah. He does 3D printing. He does really good stuff. Mm. And he'll sell around here. That's the guy that drops all the stuff, all the reviews that I do, Greg. Mm. And I've told him numerous times, because there have been so many people that will commission him to do something. And he's such a nice guy. He doesn't ask for money up front. Mm. He prints something up that's pretty expensive and big. He hits them up and they're like, oh, I don't have the money right now. And then he gets to run around, or they don't respond to him. I'm like, you need to start demanding half the money up front. Yeah. He also, I know, I don't doubt he cares that I tell this. He sold a bunch of stuff to another buddy of ours, Brent. And I think Brent had bought stuff off him before. And I went to the show. It was after Greg was already there and sold the stuff. And I was making jokes to Brent. And Brent was like, yeah, he came up here and he gives me all this stuff. And he's like, give me this much for it. And he's like, dude, wait, we agreed on this much. Mm. And he was like, yeah, no, but I only want this much. He's like, no, you take all of it. He's like, no. And he's like, dude, not only did you bring this up to me, you gave me more, and now you're saying, just give me less. No, you're taking what we agreed on. And I'm like, Greg, man, you do good stuff, man. Don't continue to do it. But at the same time, if even here in the U.S., shipping between people and 3D printed parts, especially bigger things in the heat, you know what happens.
Yeah.
You may open it up and it is just completely warped because. Mm. That heat hit it and you just, I mean, even got some gridiron stuff in that, it's just like, all right, let's go heat it up and straighten it out and hit it with some cold water and just, now you're collecting though. Mm. Are you, now you mentioned to me earlier that you are collecting with G.I. Joe,
right? Yep.
And then you're collecting the original Star Wars.
Yeah.
All right. So with your original Star Wars, are you collecting them to be complete, or do you use 3D printed parts because it's your own collection?
Yeah. So Star Wars, the Star Wars collecting community is they're a weird bunch of people. Like, everyone's really nice, and I don't want this to be a bad comment. Everyone's really nice. But when it comes to repro, Jesus Christ.
I've heard.
Yeah. They're a special group of people. I've been kicked out of an Australian Star Wars group because the guy found out that I do repro stuff.
Which, as long as you're telling people that it's a repro, there's no reason for someone... Be upset.
I do better than that. I ingrain my initials into the weapon so that you can tell that it's not real.
Yeah, just like Gridiron has their logo on most of their stuff.
Yep.
So again, like you said, if it's for me and for my collection, and it's great if you come across Han Solo's blaster.
Yeah.
But if you don't have it and you're like, well, I'm the only one looking at it, and people walking by, you know, that are in my house that are just quickly looking, I'm the one, what do I care?
Yeah.
I mean, you have to be a real anal person to be that upset by it. But I've heard about those where people get, now again, if people are lying about it,
yes,
that's, you know, that's the problem. You can't sell something complete and then they get it and it's like, all right, well, this skid on this vehicle and this gun, these aren't real.
Yeah.
That's not complete.
So, you know, like the teller is in my name. Like I openly say that I'm a repro. When I sell stuff on eBay, it has repro in capital letters. And I make it very well known that my stuff is not real. The other thing that I make known is if I'm selling something, I'll tell you if I've created it.
Okay.
You know, and I generally do not sell something if I haven't created it.
Okay. So with your collection, you do have a lot of your own reproduction stuff. Now, let me ask you this. Because I've never, like I said, I've done some 3D printing, but it's all been off Thingiverse. I find it on Thingiverse. Do you sometimes look up those figures that have your weapons in it and just kind of be like, yeah, I did that. Like,
yeah.
Just kind of be proud. Like, this is actually kind of cool. I have my own, I put my own stamp on my collection here.
So, like, I was only telling friends last night. I bought an A-wing pilot, and you know that was expensive. That's a Last 17 figure, and the weapon. I asked the guy I bought the figure off. I said, "Oh, have you got any weapons for him?" And he said, "Yeah, I'm gonna sell you this figure for $180. If you'd like the weapon, that'll be an extra $150."
Wow.
And so what it is it's this very small blaster, and it's black, I think. And then the same blaster goes with Endor Leia, and that one's gray, I think. But it's exactly the same. And I showed the guy, I'm like, oh, I think I've got it. Is it this one? He said, no. Like that one, that's only worth $30. And I'm like, oh yeah, I'm not playing with this. So I just got it's such a small weapon. So I got the magnifying glass out and I just modeled that shit. And then I spray painted it. I put it through I did that one in my resin printer. So it is perfect. Like it's probably the best one I've ever done. And yeah, painted it black. And yeah, that just sits on my figure now. And I'm super stoked with it.
See, I've recently been called slimy by some other guy over things that I didn't even do, but whatever. I've been called a lot of things. Slimy's not one of them. All right. And everyone said the same thing. They're like, yeah, I wouldn't call you slimy. To me, that is slimy. If he's selling the figure, he should be selling it complete if that's what he wants to do.
Oh, no. To me, I see it as, like, he knows that I'm not interested in paying stupid amounts of money for certain things. So he gave me the option of, I've got the figure, and if you need the weapon, I can dig it up for you.
Okay.
But it will cost
you. I guess that's it.
The guy I bought it off is very reputable in the Australian community, and yeah, he's really good.
Okay. Because I've seen a lot of people on eBay when I'm looking for a vehicle and you're going through these lots and you see like, you'll find like a ferret and then you'll see like the base of the ferret and two wheels. And then another lot, you'll see two wheels and one of the guns. Yeah. And then in this other lot, you'll see the rest of everything.
Yeah, that's
good. You're like, so you're making me bid. Which means if I bid and win two of them, I have no choice but to win the third one.
That's right.
I'm going to outbid everyone because the thing that I need, well, you have the other parts. And I know it's not like I'm grabbing them from someone else. It's like, yeah, I have this ferret. It's missing a wheel. It's missing a wheel in the cannon. Oh, okay. And then you find throws in another. It's the same person. You're like, that's slimy.
Yeah,
I thought that's what you were saying, but it sounds like he was more like, no, hey, if you want the figure, here you go. Mm. So, have you tried recreating any figures?
No. It's not something that's high on my priority list right now. Like, I think there's plenty of figures out there, and it's more often than not the weapons are the problem.
Yeah.
Or the accessories. So got some here. So, you know, like Chuckles weapon. I've got heaps of Chuckles, but the little handgun, what a painful thing. So see that. So I just recreated that.
That's yours.
Yeah, that's mine.
Oh, wow. That looks good.
Yeah. So, yeah.
You know, there's a lot of bazookas with broken thumbs. I'm just saying.
Yeah, so if you check out...
the character. Especially straight arm ones.
Channel's like Toy Polloy. So he's a... Do you know Toy Polloy? Yeah.
I know the name. I've never watched him, but I do know the name.
He was the first guy that I've seen fix thumbs and crotches on Joe's perfectly.
Really?
Yeah, and that's the best thing about Toy Polloy is he doesn't gatekeep his skills. He blatantly shows you how to fix stuff on the videos.
That's awesome.
Like, it's because of him that I was able to, like, fix battle armor skellies. And, you know, just, yeah, he's excellent. And if you also check out Kiwi Customs, so Campbell in New Zealand, he has been doing a lot of really good work recently with fixing stuff.
I believe he's in my chat all the time now.
Yes, yeah. He will be the one saying, hit that like button.
Which I like. Which, a matter of fact, if you're watching right now, hit that like button.
Hit that like button.
And don't forget to subscribe.
Yes.
A lot of people forget to subscribe. I'm one of them too. I mean, I watch so much stuff because YouTube just puts you in the algorithm. Once you start watching, it doesn't matter if you're subscribed or not. You're just in that algorithm and you continue to pop up.
It's like a flowing river.
Exactly.
You just hope you end up where you want to be.
Because sometimes you start looking like, man, I haven't seen so-and-so. They're not posted in a while. And you look, you're subscribed, and you look, and you're like, well, they've done like 83 videos in the past 2 months. Why haven't I seen one? And it's because you're not watching it.
That's right.
But then you look at the rabbit hole you went down 4 months ago, and you're like, oh, they're still sending me stuff on this.
Yeah.
No, that's really interesting. I mean, we never really talked about, like, I assume that you made some sort of repros, but I really thought you were just completing figures and reselling them, because when I see your pictures up there, I mean, it looks dead on. Mm. You know, they're not like a weird green color like the battle packs that they had.
Yeah, I'm not doing this to make money. Like, my number one thing with doing all of this is keep my brain active, keep me active. And then the second thing is I'm trying my best to help the community to have accessories for their Joes that when their dad dies and they go into some freak out, that, you know, somebody's there to help them.
So you're just trying to break even. That's all you're...
And not even... you know, it's not about breaking even or anything. Like, I understand that this is a hobby for me, so any costs associated with that, they're just, you know, lost down the hole. But 3D printing is a relatively cheap hobby anyway, so.
Hmm. It can be until you start trying to print bigger things.
Yes. Yeah.
I think a lot of people don't realize. Now, this sends a wrong message that I've been saying. When people are trying to 3D print, you shouldn't be mad that they're selling something for $250 when they're 3D printing a vehicle. Because people are like, oh, right. I can make it for $30. Well, good luck.
Give me an example. You see that sword up the top there?
The Snake Eye Sword?
Yep. So that's my design and my print and my paint.
Just for the record, I would not have been able to reach that. That looks really good.
So yeah, I did everything for this. This is all my design and everything.
That is awesome.
And that basically just comes from, well, you know, what's something cool I can do? And let's do it. So I wanted a Soundwave helmet, so I did that.
So do you 3D print cosplay? Or have you just done helmets?
I don't cosplay myself, but you know, if someone said to me, "Oh, I need this, can you help me?" I would give it a go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is interesting. We've talked so much, and yeah, I've been on the show with you, and we never really got into what you do. And I'm honestly like, I had no idea, like that Avril, the guy that loves Avril Lavigne, he's never said anything to me about, how, oh yeah, he 3D prints all this stuff. And
oh, so like if you, next time you talk to Adam, get him to show you this, all of his figures that sit behind him. I just did him up like, you know, 50 stands so that his figures could stand up. So I make all of my own stands.
Okay. And none of the pegs break off in their feet or anything?
No, so with 3D printing, you just got to understand how it works. So it's layer by layer by layer by layer. So with the foot pegs, if you, and I recently just sold someone to a guy I don't know, and I said to him, "Mate, you know, I hope you're happy with them." And he said, "I'm stoked. They look excellent." I said, "Just do me one favor. When you put the foot on and off, screw."
Yep.
Because it's a layer by layer, you have to screw and not just pull off. Otherwise, that will just come straight off.
I say that looks good. I mean, for a stand. You know, I'm not a stand guy.
But even like for, you know.
See, those are the ones that scare me, because I bought some stands for O-rings a while back, and a couple of them cracked the heels. I wasn't paying attention. So it's just a little too big. And you crack the heel. Matter of fact, one heel on a complete Duke cracked.
Right.
Really made me mad. Luckily, I acquired another one, which was odd. But I mean, it was mint, but now I have a cracked heel, and I didn't glue it back on. But if I ever wanted to get rid of it, because hey, you know what? I don't need two Dukes. Then I have to either sell the one that doesn't have a cracked heel, which why would I do that? Or I have to say, hey, yeah, I have this Duke here. It has a cracked heel. You know, but
from a maker's perspective, like I've seen that before, and it's the laziness related to sales.
Yeah.
So these people out there that they're selling the, you know, the clear set stands and stuff, and they're just getting them made in China. What they do is they make it generally one foot peg size that can hold Star Wars, G.I. Joe, classifieds, whatever. And they're all different.
Yeah.
Like they're all different foot peg size, but these guys just make one foot peg size. So on one, it's going to be loose. On one, it's going to fit perfectly. And on the other one, it's probably going to break your figure.
Yeah. So when I bought new ones, I picked them up from one of my local toy shops. And they're Small Joes. If you know the website. And I told them, can you put this on a figure? He's like, I guess why? I'm like, because I bought some, it snapped a heel. I'm like, okay, I'm not going to put one on. I'm not going to buy these. I'm not going to put one on unless I know it fits.
Yeah.
The small Joe ones, they seem to work awesome. But I have a feeling they are made. They may have those made for the O-ring, the 80.
That's right.
Yeah. But they fit awesome. Those ones are absolutely perfect. And even though, again, I'm not a stand guy, I will give you a break if it's on 1/18 scale figures, because they're much smaller.
Yeah.
When it comes to 1/12 scale, learn how to stand your figures. But that's just me. Don't let little old me shame you into not using them.
Well, it's collecting, right? So, yeah. You know, the biggest thing about collecting is you just do you, and yep, you do whatever makes you happy.
Yep, I agree. Yeah, and as long as you're, and again, just because I say something, I'm just a little shit. All right, screw off. I'm a very vocal guy, and a lot of it has to do with I want someone to push back at me. I want, like, when I tell people soccer sucks, and they're like, "Dude, that's not cool." I'm like, "Soccer sucks. I don't care." And yeah. What if I tell you skateboarding sucks? Then that's awesome. You tell me skateboarding sucks, and I say, good, I still love it. That's all you need to say. All right, you think soccer sucks? That's cool. Guess what? I love playing it. Cool. That's all that matters, right? I'm just kind of, you know, this is why some people think I'm an asshole. You're probably right.
I've found it's just an age thing. Like, as I'm getting older, I just don't care anymore. Like, if someone's like, "Oh man, that figure sucks." Okay, man. Like, who cares? Yep. Just don't buy it.
Yeah.
I've
always been like this, even when I was younger. You know, but as a YouTuber, it helps to have an opinion, because if you just don't have an opinion, you become a monotone person that either likes everything or hates everything.
Yeah.
This way, at least I'm animated when someone says that you're an asshole. Like, okay, well, that's cool.
Too, like, you've got kids. You know how much brain power and time the children suck out of your life.
Yes.
Like, you know, these recent things that have been happening in the toy community, in the Joe community, I just don't have time for it, mate. Like, I've got so much other stuff to worry about.
You know, I really wish I could. I mean, I understand what you're saying. Mm. I have been obviously pretty vocal about Viper Island after everything that happened. And a lot of that goes to the whole, you know, back to the whole issue that I am, you know, I'm answering stuff, and now I'm going to have to answer dumb questions because of one guy. Mm. Now, he's gone now. Yeah. He's gone now, but now there's a whole nother issue with someone else.
Yeah.
And I've been drug into it. You know, and whether I like him or not, I don't. All right. And he said some stuff that I went, "All right, well, fuck you. I don't care. Like, you have an issue with me getting an interview with Lenny, and you want to not use my name, but make comments about this or that, whatever. I don't care. I don't need you. We don't do the same content."
Yeah.
You know, you do these three minute bursts. I don't do that. And YouTube is a big world. I don't care.
Yeah.
But when, you know, people are sending you messages saying this guy said this, and that's, I mean, there's, you know, things that you're just like, all right, well, I don't really care, but it is one of those things where it's like, why am I being drugged into this?
That's right.
You know, I've said this before. I say this about our politicians. Mm-hmm. And I say this about me. There are more than enough reasons not to like me. You don't have to make one up. All right. The politicians. When I hear someone lie about something a politician said, my kids, like, they don't realize it, I'm like, that's not true. There are more than enough reasons not to like, I'm not going to get political, but either one of our candidates. You don't need to make one up. All right. They've done more than enough shitty, stupid things. Yes. You know, and I say the same thing about, you don't like me, that's fine. But please, I don't want to read something that isn't true, because there's a huge fucking list. All right.
Yeah.
Go find one of those. All right. Don't add one that isn't there. All right.
It's just a life thing. People are addicted to drama.
I love drama, but I don't love being part of the drama.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I love watching it from afar.
Hmm.
I think Viper Scout actually said that in something where he was like, I love drama. I'm not going to lie. Just watching it from afar. You know, it's always nice to be the person that pokes the bear when you're not rich, but that poker is far enough that bear can't get to you. And you're just stirring, you know, you're just stirring the flame. You're stoking the flame, however you want to say.
It's not a good thing, though. Like, collecting and loving toys isn't about drama. Like, the only drama you should have is, you know, like, do you like V1 Zartan or V2 Zartan? Like, that's the level of the drama. Someone stealing content and, you know, we're all going on personal vendettas. I know, like, it's hard for people to avoid that, and I understand that. But it's not great for the community.
Oh, it's awful.
Yeah.
It is awful. And I can say this, you know, we just got back from Joe Fest.
Mm.
One of the best times of my life.
Yeah.
There was no clicks. I didn't run into any assholes. Mm. There were probably some people that saw me, didn't like me, and just avoided me, and that's perfectly fine.
That's great.
Or maybe some people didn't even realize who I was, you know, and that's fine too. You know, this whole YouTube, it's pretty vast, right?
Mm.
If you don't like my content, you don't have to watch it. If you like my Monday show, but you like what Yojo Jerk is doing and he runs opposite to me and you like watching him more, you can watch him and then watch me on the replay. Or pop on, you know, it's like, I'm not going to take offense to it.
No.
You know, it's my job. And then I talk about this numerous times to give content that makes people want to come in, not dislike other people.
Yeah.
But I agree. The drama doesn't help anything. The only thing that I found is there's drama in everything. When I was working at the, in a gymnastics place, they started telling me the issues with the girls team and the fundraising and all this drama. And I'm like, this is supposed to be to get the team to different competitions.
Yeah.
Why is there inner fighting?
Yeah.
Why is there, you know, people that are accusing other people of stealing the money? This is supposed to be going to these girls. And then obviously to help get the families there at the same time, because they obviously need a parent. It makes no sense to me.
Yeah.
But when you watch it from afar, it's a lot of fun to watch. All right. Mm. We all love watching that train wreck, right?
I guess just like military background wise, like my, you know, watching drama unfold is great for 10 seconds. And then, you know, you got to move on and get your job done. So when I see things like this happening, I'm just like, oh God, like, can you all please just stop? It's really frustrating.
I can definitely see that point of view. Mm. And you're looking at it from a different, I mean, you're looking at it from a military.
Yeah.
Which you're right. You have to move on. Mm. You know, and in the military, they do a lot of things. They have to do a lot of things that you would say, how could you do something like that? But hey, this is what I have to do to continue on with my mission.
You know?
Where you probably, looking at stupid, petty things like.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
And I understand that.
Mm.
And I love it. I love your point of view, you know, because, again, we all have different points of view. Not saying you're wrong, because I actually agree.
It's all opinions.
Yeah, and I agree with you more than anything. Like I said, I love to see the drama. That's fun to watch, but it's like, I'd rather not be brought into it unless if I'm actually doing something.
Yeah, and that's exactly the thing. Like, I know people that are in the drama, and I just don't engage because.
Oh, you're pretty in. Okay, I'm not even gonna try and say the word. I can see it. I can hear it in my head. And don't you hate when there's a word there that you know? And okay, I'm not even gonna try because right now everyone is in the chat in the future going this.
It's busting the word out.
So, what are you collecting now?
So I'm finishing off my Star Wars collection. I'm pretty much
not your 95 Power of the Force, like May the Power of the Force, because you could finish that off for about $300.
Oh no, this is all. And I found it weird lately. Like someone will say, "Oh, when you say Star Wars, you mean the 90s vintage, right?" I'm like, "That's not vintage," and they'll be like, "It is vintage." Oh God, that crap.
The Power of the Force, that Power of the Force, it is vintage. It's almost 30 years old. Sure. Isn't that messed up?
But yeah, original series, yeah. Star Wars. And I think I need to do a stock take, and I don't have all the weapons and accessories. But figure wise, I think I'm just missing Blue Snaggletooth now, which is an exciting part of life. That's the case.
So what happens when you complete that? So you're collecting other stuff, correct?
Yeah.
Are you trying to complete anything else? Because you only have one figure. Or are you looking at the next thing that you want to complete?
I'm not a completionist. And that's, okay. You know, it's evident why I don't have all the accessories for Star Wars. I don't have every single G.I. Joe vehicle and thing that's made. I have the things that I like and that are dear to me. So I have Mask as well. I absolutely love Mask, but I've only got what's sitting in that top part of my cabinet. So, and then below that, three rows of Motu, vintage Motu.
So you don't do the Origins line?
No, just because here's the problem with collectors, right? It's not actually collecting. It's some type of weird addiction to not stopping buying stuff. It's a purchasing problem. So how do I control
one of those guys?
I stick to years. So I stick to the 80s generally.
But you do have some classified.
I do have some.
But you said it's character driven.
Yeah, so, you know, like old mates like Lowlight, like I knew no matter what Lowlight looked like, I was going to buy it.
Okay.
Whereas, you know, I can easily not get any other classified.
Not even Pimp Daddy Destro?
No, we have too many of those here. That's literally, it's the only classified peg warmer we have in Australia is that one figure.
Believe me, I remember when you guys told me and I was like,
what? Yeah, it's unreal. There's still
Ronnie Trickshot. I'm sorry. Ronnie Trickshot's
the statue, the trophy,
The trophy. Yeah. It was so fucking awesome. All right. Yeah. Like that was so awesome.
That's how many Destros we have, is people are making cricket trophies out of them.
I totally thought he was like bullshitting when he said that. And then he grabs it and you're like, what? And you're like, it's the only thing we can find.
Yeah.
And people can't, I mean, I guess you can find it here. I actually saw it today at Surgeon Red's. Mm. But it's never been, from what I know, it's never been at Target or Walmart, because I think it was a fan channel. But I've never seen it anywhere else other than like an actual like toy store. So the fact that you guys just have them, just
there's still like five of them down at my local toy shop for about 15 Australian each.
So what does that come out to be? About $12?
Oh, like $9 American or something. I see them every time. I saw them 2 days ago. Like, they're there every time.
I love it. So you do collect some. So you do collect some classified. Do you collect any like Black Series? Is there anything else modern that you pick up?
Yeah. So, something I'm trying to do on my channel is because I collect so much vintage stuff, and I have really enjoyed a lot of the recent Star Wars stuff. So Ahsoka and just all that new stuff. So when Black Series figures go on sale, so they're about 15 Australian on sale, I'll just buy them and I'll open them up on my channel and, you know, just display them out in the front room.
But everything stays confined to that room of yours.
I've got stuff in this room. And then in my front lounge, which is, you know, your movie type room.
Okay.
I've got two cabinets, which has the full Star Wars and like some Joes. I've got a Nintendo collection.
Okay.
So a whole bunch of Game Boys and an original NES with the Zapper. And then on another shelf, I've got some Marvel stuff. And yeah, that's it for that room. It's just more of a looks cool when you're watching movies type room.
And about how old are your daughters?
13 and 16.
All right, so you got a little bit of time. But yeah. You know, eventually, you hope they move out. I'm not sure.
I'm not sure
if my son's ever going to move out, but that means there's another room. Do you really want guests over, or would you rather have another collector? I'm just saying. You know, sometimes you need to start planning ahead of time because you realize how long you've been collecting already. And I really think
it's good having limited space because it keeps me under control.
Not me. I don't know what you're talking about, but man, we're living in different worlds, right? So what else? Like, what else are you collecting? Anything? Any odd stuff, or is it?
I collect basketball cards.
All right. So you wouldn't. So when we were talking about cards before, you weren't into
no.
basketball. So are you into basketball now, or are you just?
I'm not into watching basketball, but I appreciate good basketball cards. So with the recent passing of Jerry West the other day,
yep.
I purchased a couple of Jerry West signature cards. And I've, you know, there's a recent show out called Winning Time. I don't know if you've seen that.
The HBO one.
Yeah, the Lakers one.
Yes.
Yeah, so, it's cool things, I think. Like, I really like the idea of those memorabilia cards from basketball where you're getting, you know, gameplay jersey swatches on the cards and the signatures. And, yeah, I like the idea of them.
That's pretty cool. Have you watched Clipped yet? The story of the Clippers?
No.
It's on Hulu. I don't know.
Yeah, we don't get Hulu here.
Okay. But it should be, again, it's owned by Disney, so I would assume it's on FX.
Okay.
So it's on Hulu. I don't know if you guys get FX. I mean, it's owned by Disney.
I'll have a look on the Disney Channel.
Yeah, so Clipped is the story of the Clippers.
Okay.
And Donald Sterling, when it basically came out that he's just a little prejudiced. but it's done by Donald Sterling, the owner, is played by Al Bundy. Ed, I can't think of his name.
Ed O'Neill.
Hmm. And it's pretty damn good.
My son and I
actually watched. But then he asked like questions, and I'm like, I don't really want to answer questions because I already know what happens. You know, he's forced to sell the team, but of course, anything for a TV show is going to be animated, I guess you could say. It's going to be
like fascinated me with that winning time that every single character in it looked like an asshole. Like the show made every single person in the show look like an asshole.
Yeah, it did.
It was unusual.
Yeah, because I had HBO Max at the time. So that's one of those ones that I'm going to have to go back probably in the winter, because there's some series that when I got rid of it, they weren't done yet, that you got to go back. But I would wait till second season comes out, because that was really good. That was excellent. And you're right. It makes everyone seem like assholes. You know, Magic Johnson's just banging every girl.
it was funny because, like, the people we had over last night, their daughter plays and is really, really into basketball. And I said to the parents, I was showing them the Jerry West cards, and I'm like, oh, have you seen that show Winning Time? It's about the Lakers in the 70s. And they were like, oh, no. And the daughter asked about it. I said, no, you cannot watch that.
It's not really so much about basketball as much as
the lifestyle.
Yes. Yeah. Their life. But you know what would be good for her to watch if it is still on there? And unfortunately, they got rid of it. And that is it was on Disney Plus. John Stamos is the coach. God, I can't think of it. But he plays a high school girls coach.
Right.
So he comes over from college because he loses his job because of his temper. I cannot think of the name of it. My daughter and I watched it, and we loved it. But it's hilarious.
Does his assistant coach have a witty saying like "cut it out"?
No.
Sorry, that's a Full House reference.
Oh. That's right, it is. But, God, oh my God, it's going to drive me nuts. And of course, there's no one in the chat to tell me what it is.
Yeah.
His assistant coach is a hot female. That's what I can tell you. But it sucks that it ended because they didn't actually get a, but he does this thing where, at the end of, like, when he's talking to his daughter, he does this, what is it, TCKS, Take Care, Keep Safe.
Okay.
And he calls it an acronym, right? And everyone's like, no one says that. And he's like, oh, but they're going to one day. So my daughter and I do it all the time. Like, we send it back and forth, and I know as soon as she sees it, she's going to be laughing, and she'll send it back to me. It was really great that I tried to explain the whole story to you without giving you the name of the show.
I really like this show. You can never watch it.
Damn it. But it is. Hold on. I got to look it up now. So is basketball, like, popular there?
Like NBA or basketball in general?
Both.
I'm going to make a statement for the rest of Australia and say basketball in our Premier League is not popular.
Okay.
It's way down in terms of people turning up to watch it, and no one really talks about it all that much.
Okay.
And it doesn't help the recent person that we sent to the NBA was Josh Giddey.
Well, it happens. We send a lot of bad guys to the NBA too. They're bad players. Bad players.
Giddey's a good player, and he was a really good rookie. He just made bad life decisions, and I think wasn't probably helped out by the team.
It's called Big Shot. It wasn't really hard. Okay. It's on Disney Plus. I think it's like two or three seasons, 20 episodes.
So I want Big Shot and Clipped.
Yes. Now Clipped, I wouldn't tell. I mean, Big Shot is one you could tell the your friend's daughter that she could watch.
Yeah. Okay.
Clipped, I would say no. It's not as bad because it's on FX, but right. You're right. Winning Time.
Yeah.
You know, I used to tell my son would always ask if he watched Deadpool. It took him forever to figure out that I'm at work. The DVDs are right there. He can watch it if he wanted to.
Yeah.
He's like, when can I watch it? I'm like, when you're 18. And never with me in the room. Why? Because there are things that I don't ever want to explain. And there are some things that I don't want to be in the room with you when you're watching Deadpool.
I showed my kids the fairy tale version of Deadpool 2. Have you seen that?
I have not. I know which one you're talking about.
It's really good.
One where where it has the Wonder Years boy in it.
Yeah.
Yep. I know what you're talking. I've never seen it though.
Yeah, it's good though? It's really good. Yeah. Like old mate wakes up in his bedroom from the Princess Bride.
Yes.
And he wakes up and he's like gaffer taped to the bed or strapped to the bed so he can't move. And Deadpool's there with the storybook, like the old grandpa and Princess Bride. Classic.
I mean, and that's not on the DVDs either, or the Blu-ray, shall I say.
You had to. It was definitely a Blu-ray release.
It's got to be on Disney Plus, right?
I don't know.
You think it's got to be.
I haven't seen it anywhere else apart from that Blu-ray that I bought.
Because I know they had it in theaters. Because I had thought about taking him into it, and I was like, it's probably going to suck because it's just PG. But then when people saw it, they said, no, it was...
Yeah, it was really well done.
Yeah.
Basically, when there was excessive blood or gore, they just cut to Deadpool with the book, and he would describe it.
Oh.
So you still see the same movie, but it just doesn't have the blood and gore scenes. Like, I think when – you remember when Juggernaut rips Deadpool in half, you don't see stuff like that.
Okay. See, now you got to go look for it. All right.
But to answer your question on toys, like, I've recently I picked up some Battle Beasts.
All right.
That's weird for me. Like, I do remember – I remember them – like from a way back, but they're very expensive here in Australia, like $25 to $50 a piece type expensive.
So I think that's what, I think they were saying Lenny is always mentioning that because he wants to do that. So I believe it's a Hasbro owns the property to it.
Yeah.
I think they were saying he's always bringing up Battle Beast. And they were making jokes about it, saying, "Yeah, it's almost like on the hour, all of a sudden he will make a Battle Beast comment." You know,
right.
All anyone wants, and I'm not one of them per se, is people want Mask. That's what they want to see.
Really. Oh yeah, 1,000%.
See, I mean, I like Mask, but I could give or take it.
It's like. I watched a stream the other day, and at the end of it, the dude was playing the old commercials and stuff from the 80s, and he played the opening scene for Mask, and I was just sitting there just,
the grid that comes.
Yeah. It's just so nice. I think the concept behind it is just beautiful.
I think my issue with redoing Mask is... you have to figure out what scale. And I don't think 1/12 scale works. I think 1/18 scale would be perfect. Because we already see vehicles. We've already seen the vehicles, right?
Well, but they've already done, like, one of my most favorite modern toys is that the combination they did of Mask and G.I. Joe. They did a Matt Tractor figure, and it's beautiful.
Yeah, so they could do the figures in 1/12 to do a bunch of vehicles, especially considering a lot of times they're going to expand out.
Yeah.
They're more complicated than, let's say, like a vamp. I don't think people are willing to pay for it. But yeah, I've been wrong about that. Because I said, hey, you know what? People are not going to want these classified scale vehicles when they start seeing how much space they're taking up. And then I'm watching people buy like 5, 6, 7 of them, like the Stingers, and they already have obviously five amps, and they bought five Hiss tanks, and then they bought 5 Dragonflies, and you're going, I don't care what you do for work.
Yeah.
And I don't care how much money you spend, but I need to know how you have space.
That's right.
Because, I mean, well, obviously, when you look at their house or whatever, you see their space, you can kind of figure out they have money, especially if you're spending that much. But it's like, how do you justify? Because you're not even talking about the figures. You're not even talking about the trouble bubbles that they have, and obviously the ferrets, like all this other stuff. And it's like, you're buying all of these. Oh, and then they probably bought the Violiverse stuff, and you're just going, all right.
Well, yeah, I can't do it.
I'm buying one of each. And it's, I'm already looking at it and I'm going.
But I think, like, you look at the recent announcement of the Ghostbusters in the 3.75 line, and I haven't heard anyone say anything negative about it. And that's a real good indicator to me. It was a good indicator to me that we can take these other toy lines and do something different with them. So, like, with a mask, don't put it into classified. Release it as 3.75 and give it a go.
So here's where I think that would fail. And that is because the Ghostbuster collectors do not cross over with the G.I. Joe collectors. And I'm not saying none of them.
Yeah.
For the most part, they don't cross over. People want that mask because they're G.I. Joe collectors and they want to incorporate it into it. But I'm with you. And my only issue with those Ghostbusters O-ring figures is that they own G.I. Joe and they won't do it. So they've licensed it out to Super 7, which I saw the figures. Well, at least what they look like. They're not painted. And I think the Crimson Twins are absolutely awesome. It is exactly what Brian Flynn said. We are doing characters that have never been done.
Yeah.
So to see it in the same packaging with the mirror on the side, but they're in suits and the artwork is almost the same as what we had. I'm like, that is awesome. That is exactly what we want to see. But the fact that Hasbro isn't doing it, it's like, if it's good enough for Ghostbusters, and then it's $45 for all four of them.
Yeah.
And we were paying $44 for the 2-pack.
Yeah.
Which you own the license to. And they're just they're remolds of things that we already have. I already have those figures. I don't need them again.
I don't understand a lot of the decisions that get made. But that's okay. I'll move on.
But again, I still do like the O-rings. You know, I still like the 1/18 scale. I have a huge room dedicated to it. I got those, well, you really can't see them. A bunch of the Delta 17 figures.
Yeah, they're great.
Did you get some?
Yeah, I bought Shepard and Death Sparrow.
Oddly enough, those are the two that I picked up at Joe Fest.
Yeah, they to me, out of the range, they look like the two that I wanted to try.
All right, so you probably know the issue with the legs where they don't go fully, do the full L.
No.
So, like, their legs have limited movement.
Okay. And
it's because the T-hook is too thick. So they gave T-hooks away, or they'll send it to you. But I'm assuming you probably have T-hooks. Oh. I'm sorry. Oh, the female may not have the problem. So push her legs up like she was going to sit down in a vehicle.
Get it off this stand.
Females may not have the same problem.
Yeah, that doesn't. Oh, hang on.
Okay, so grab the other one that you just said you have.
I can't think of the name. Shepherd.
Yeah, Shepherd. I know he has it because I just replaced it yesterday. I know, like I have Leonidas. He had an issue. I changed his yesterday. I actually did a video. But see, yeah, you see how they don't go up all the way. That's as far as they go. Yeah,
definitely doesn't go up all the way.
So the T hook, so the T hooks they gave us to replace it, they're much thinner. Okay. I just did a video on it to show people how to replace them. But someone had made a comment that they just used one of their replacement T hooks to fix the legs. Yeah, but if you're just gonna stand the figure up like that, it doesn't really matter, I guess.
Yeah.
But like, if you want to sit them down in a vamp or something like that, they don't work because you're bending the waist. And that was my biggest complaint on in my first review that I did. And one of the reasons why they asked if I would be interested in purchasing some, before everyone else got the figures, was they wanted an honest review. A lot of people won't give an honest review, and they knew that I would be honest and not like try and bury them. And I'm good friends with Ken. I feel like I'm pretty good friends with Steve, the owner. I mean, I hung out with him a lot at Joe Fest, and I've talked to him before. And that was one of the things they went, because they already knew about it, but they didn't know the reason why. And then come to find out, the T hook is just too thick. And if you pop, like, if you take it apart and put and grab another T hook from another Joe and look at it, I'm assuming that it's probably much thinner, because the ones that were given out to people that already bought the figures, when I looked at them in the video to show everyone, you can see exactly how much. But that's the reason why. And it's one of those things where they told me, and you're like, is that really gonna fix it? I was blown away at how much more articulation it had once I.
Yeah, that's interesting.
If you're just going to stand them there and you're not going to put them in, you know, vehicles, then it doesn't really matter to you.
Nah.
To me, it's just nice that, hey, this was the first wave of figures. They saw a problem. They addressed it to all the people that purchased them. They're trying to send these out to people that need them if they're interested. I'm like, that's how a company's supposed to be run.
That's exactly right. Like, the average human being knows that people make mistakes.
Yes.
So to see two guys start a company and this is their first effort, like I reviewed both of these and I gave, great marks to them, not because of anything other than they are great figures.
Yep.
They're exactly what I would like to purchase.
And, you know, and Steve, he's the main owner of it. You know, it wasn't a Kickstarter. He got backers. So once you bought the figures, they were being shipped, you know?
Yeah.
And he found the right factories. And he didn't go with the same factory that everyone else is going with. And a lot of it had to do with because they were so backed up. But when you look at that paint on those, man, there's no issues with them. Yeah. They just look so good. And then, you know, conversely, you get those G.I. Joe ones, those G.I. Joe O-rings that they redid, and you're like, God, that looks awful. Like, Duke's eyes are all over the damn place. some people had them way worse. You know, I don't think mine were that bad, but other people had them like they were just way up. But every single speck of paint was good. The only issue ended up being that T-hook, at least that I could see, and they addressed it.
If that's the worst thing that comes from a first release from two dudes who have just started the company, like, that's an actual major, like, amazing thing. If you're an established company that has been doing this for decades and you can't even get a face sculpt right, you're a dunderhead, bro. Like, you're incompetent. There's no other, you know, like, the comparison is there. There's startups doing the right job that is excellent, and then there's an established company who can't get their shit together.
And I think, again, when it comes to Hasbro, let's be honest. I admit they're a billion-dollar company. G.I. Joe is not a billion-dollar, it's not a billion-dollar property. It's a million-dollar property. But at the same time, you're Hasbro. You should be able to say, we want the best.
Yes.
Right? We're making the most. We want the best. There should be no issues. And I think so many times it falls back on the team, and it's like, it's not Lenny's fault. Lenny's not saying, hey, you know what? Put some shit stuff on there. This is when they become cheap and they get it and they're like, oh, you got to be kidding me. That plastic-free packaging had nothing to do with them. And
I would rather just vote with my wallet. And that's why I don't really buy classifieds, just because they're just not what I want. So, you know, I'm not gonna start a YouTube channel saying classifieds suck and then just pay out on every single classified and I just won't buy them. That's simple.
Yeah.
But when I can get these two figures for $120 shipped to my address from America, from a startup company, I just can't understand how another company can't do that.
I'm with you 100%. Yeah.
Like, I'm not a basher of, I have nothing against Hasbro. I love Hasbro, but it's very, it's super frustrating when all I want to do is spend money and you can't give me what I think most people want, which is an O-ring. Just give me the O-ring, bro.
I don't think most people want it. I disagree with you on that. I think a lot of people do. And my biggest thing, and I've been wrong before, obviously.
Well, the Super 7 thing, when they start releasing that figures, that'll be the indicator, right?
I think so. I think so to a point. You know, there's a lot of O-ring Kickstarters, and obviously Delta 17, not a Kickstarter, but they're another O-ring, and they did wonderful. I would honestly say they were some of the biggest talks of Joe Fest. Like, when you start seeing the reviews and when you talk to people, I think they were so impressed because, first off, they had the product right there.
Yeah.
You could pick it up and buy it. Everyone's looking at that RoboSkull, myself included, going, God, I remember when I spent $250 on that 2 years ago, and it's not here yet. Or I had a nice long talk with Cosign Longbow. And I talked about, it's been a long time, man, and you guys haven't given us anything. And he said, yeah, we know. And they had a figure there, and they're like, as soon as we get this figure in, it's being shipped out, because even though it's going to cost us more money to ship it rather than ship them all together, people have been waiting. And you need some good faith. And he even said, if you want this figure and you've already backed it, you can just email me and add it. And then as soon as it comes in, I will ship it out. And the figure is based, it's coming out of the same factory, and it uses a lot of the similar parts that the Skeletron does. So like the O-ring Skeletron, which is an amazing figure. It is awesome. So I'm like, all right, well, I'll be happy when these other ones come out, because I know how good those ones were. Or that one, shall I say. Because the Skeletron figures are dead on. But they're all working together. But unfortunately, unfortunately for them, Skeletron was first in line. So,
but when you mention, like, Ken and the company choosing the right factory, like, these are life choices, right? They're not a series of fortunate decisions.
Oh, yeah.
They made business decisions, right?
Oh, yeah. There were specific factories that they said that they looked at, and they chose not to go with this one because even though they're good, they are way behind. and they take longer. And he was able to find another one that I'm assuming, by the look of everything, is just as good.
Yeah.
But clearly they made mistakes too, because you look at the issue with the T-hooks. They got it, you know, they got it addressed, and you know it's gonna be taken care of.
As you just mentioned though, like, it's nice that you can hold a figure and say, oh, there's a problem with the T-bar, rather than people from who are paid for longbow who are still waiting for their figures. Like a figure with a problem that you can hold in hand is way better than, I don't even know if the figure I paid for that's coming 2 years later may have a problem.
Yeah. And again, like, you're going, okay, well, I have a figure out of that factory.
Yeah.
From a different company, but they're using some of the same parts because they're all working together. So you can assume it, but at the same time, it's like, I backed four figures from Callsign Longbow and Operation Recall.
Yeah.
I swear there's no timeline that I'm ever going to get them.
Yeah.
I don't think that they're going to rip me off, but at the same time, it's like, it's been, I think, 2 years or close to 2 years by summer, by the end of summer. And let's be honest, they're not going to be here. But RoboSkull is going to be coming within, should be coming by the end of the year. I believe they're finishing up, right? But they started getting figures in, different accessories, and they started shipping them out or put them on sale. So I got to really see the quality. Where here I'm kind of sitting and you're going, all right, well, I backed, you know, when I backed both of those, I did like $120.
Yeah.
Four figures. So $120 is still $120, not like poo-poo.
That's right. Yeah.
But if I'm out $120, I'm out $120, right? I spent it, I spent $120 on a lot of stupid things that gave me nothing back. But it wasn't like people that went all in for $600, $700, $800.
Yeah, that's right.
And now you're just waiting.
Yeah.
But again, my financial situation might be different. $600 is setting me back a lot. Other people just, they plop down $600 and you go, okay. We live in different homes.
Yeah.
You know, so, but is there anything else that you want to say before we kind of wrap this up?
I think it's, so I've mentioned it before, we did an Anzac Day special with Zazel, and sort of the thing that come up about supporting channels. And I think it's a really notable thing, maybe, I don't know. From my point of view, I got asked, you know, what channels do I support? And my answer was, I support channels that support us, as in, you know, like, I always tune into your channel, always tune into other channels, because the people at those channels actually talk to you, they engage with you. And I think that's a really important thing. So I found there's some channels out there that don't engage with the, you know, thousands of subs that they have. They act like rock stars and sit there and they're all mighty and shit, which is great. Do what you got to do. But, you know, there's some really nice people out there, yourself included. You may swear a lot, but you're very kind-hearted. That's what I like. So I would say to the people watching this, like, don't get involved in the drama. The drama is bad for all of us. And just have a think about who you're supporting, because there's people with YouTube channels that really, really care about toys and the people, like, playing with them and collecting them. And then there's people out there that, in my opinion, don't give a shit. That's just my point of view.
There are a lot of channels, and I'm just going to piggyback on what you said, because I think what you said was wonderful. And I agree with it 100%. I think there's a lot of people, when they get to where I'm at, I'm approaching 5,000 subs.
Yeah.
And I've said it before. It's just a status quo.
Yeah.
Are people watching it, right? Are people watching it? That's the biggest thing. But I think there's a lot of people that, as they get bigger, they really only want to associate with people that are bigger than them or around the same, because that's how they feel they're going to grow.
Yeah.
And, you know, not to pat myself on the back, But when I did that whole live stream where I was going to call YouTubers out, and I did, I called them out, and I called out channels that I enjoy watching that I think people need to be watching. Yeah. And they were almost all small channels, right?
Yeah.
The amount of people that messaged me to say thank you, talked about it on their live streams, people saying just from that shout out, I got 15 new subs. Like that's like that's what this is supposed to be all about. Because like I've said before, if your channel does better than mine, then good for you.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
My job is to make my channel the best that it could be. Not make your channel not to make your channel worse, to make myself look better.
Yeah.
And I don't think a lot of people see that. They look at the big guys and they're like, I want to have Shardamus Prime on, and I want to have Dan Larson on. Yeah. That's gonna grow. I want to have Skeletron on. I want like they want to have creators. And there's nothing wrong with that, but sometimes they stop talking to the people and they don't know the little channels. And you go to Joe Fest and you start realizing they don't know who the fuck anyone is here. They know who, everyone has panels and everyone that has a booth, but all the people that we're talking to, they have no idea who they are.
Yeah.
And it's because they don't go on like Oz's Clubhouse and shoot the shit with everyone. And they don't interact with the other people. And I think there are people that they come to a point that they don't even want to talk to them anymore. They might tune in to hear them, but they don't try and talk because their voice is never heard. So I agree 100% with you. And I do appreciate the kind words.
Like I definitely don't want to sound like someone that is just hanging on the peripherals of the drama, because I understand that the drama's there. But you know, this, in my opinion, I've been watching this all unfold, staying out of it. And it, to me, it's a disgusting side of the community. Like it's just gross. And it, I think the worst thing has been, just this tribalism thing of, as soon as the battle lines were drawn, you got people like starting up hashtag I'll stand with blah blah, or it's about the toys, you idiots. Like, stop it.
Can I? Okay, so I gotta say that when it came to this whole Viper Island thing, and people were doing the hashtag I stand with so and so,
yeah,
I rolled my eyes because I'm like,
yeah,
when someone says I stand with something, it should really mean something important.
Yeah.
Right? Not I stand with, again, I understand why you are supporting them.
Yeah.
But none of these YouTubers were like, their lives were at risk. None of them were dying for something. No. And again, I was the first person that loses my Instagram from that.
Yeah.
All right. Viper Island came after me. I'm not going to sit there and say, oh, I didn't do anything. I made fucking memes about the guy, all right? So it's not like I was like this, but it did piss me off because, again, the fact that you have no one to contact on Instagram and all the messages that and they don't even tell you, it's just gone. Mm. And then 90 days later, it came back, which is what a lot of people said, hey, I think after 90 days, because so-and-so lost theirs for something, it just
came up.
Was I pissed? Yeah. And most of it had to do with the messages that I had with fairly important people in the industry that I'm friendly with. I wouldn't call them friends, right? They're good acquaintances. Doesn't mean they're going to follow my backup channel, but all the stuff that my daughter and I would ship back, would send back and forth. But the whole hashtag of like, I stand, and I was like, I understand what you're doing, but I really think like when I stand by someone, like if you say I stand by Ukraine, right? Okay. That's because they're in a war, right? Yeah. Someone is invading them, right? No one invaded your YouTube and like showed up through your fucking screen with a gun and was like trying to take over your home and your family.
I when those hashtags were happening, like that to me, that was the point, like the ultimate point of stupidity. That's how I knew that this had just gone too far. But anyway, I hope we can all just move on and all be friends again and everything's okay.
There's another there's another feud going on right now. So
I know.
After that, there'll be another feud. And after that, there'll be another feud.
Yeah.
You know, hopefully I can eventually get out of it because I shouldn't be in this one. Like I said, if you want to know my opinion, I will tell you my opinion. But yeah. Again, that's it. We're allowed to have opinions. We don't have don't have to like each other.
Yeah. No, that's right. I do want to just do a quick shout out to 3-Star Drawl and Pop Blender for such small channels. I've actually really been enjoying their content, and you know that's just from the small channels perspective. That's how you start a channel, I believe.
I have said for both of them. They're cousins, right? And this was before I met them, because I met them at JoeFest. And I would consider both of them pretty good friends.
Yeah.
They both have a command when doing shows. And I told both of them that. Mm. You guys both have this presence and a command on how to grab an audience.
Yeah.
And I'm really happy for Matthew and my moderator. That him and Pop Blender are able to do a show that I think is really going to get a lot of traction.
Yeah.
Darren, 3-Star Drawl, I will once again say, I hate your name. I think you should stick with 3-Star. You should stick with Down South 77. Don't like 3-Star. I already told him this. Like this was stuff. That's why I call him Darren now, because I'm like, you know what? Screw it. Because I can never find out who he is, right? Like, Darren. But they both have, I think, a really good presence of how they do their streams. Mm. And again, Pop Blender is really putting a lot of time and effort into it, and he reached out and asked Matthew to do something with him, and which is really good because I'm going to be doing this every week rather than every other week, and kind of have to put Punks on Film on the hiatus. I do want to do something with it later on, but we need to reformat it and figure out how we want to do it. It's a lot more effort, a lot more work than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
Doing a lot more work than I thought it was going to be. I'm glad you gave them a shout out because they're both two really, really good people. And they're part of
like there's a lot of, you know, I don't have a whole bunch of time during the week. So I have to be careful what I devote my viewing to. And, you know, your shows are long, but I will sit there and watch the whole lot.
I do not take offense if you don't watch the whole thing. I do
watch the whole thing. And ones like Pop Blender and 3-Star, they've just got that, just the nice feeling of you want to be there. You know, it's like your show, you want to listen. Hmm.
They both are very mellow. Yeah. I can't say the same for my show. There may be times that I get a little bit more animated. Honestly, I didn't even realize I used my hands as much. So after my ex and I had split up, and a girl that I was talking to made a comment about, I can't believe you haven't hit your steps during this conversation. I was like, what are you talking about? It's like, all you do is use your hands. I'm like, no, I don't. And then I asked my boss, and he's like, so bad. And the worst thing is, when I do a live, I have it going on over here, but it's like a 5-second delay.
Yeah.
That way I can know if I start stuttering or not stuttering, but if I start freezing up or anything, right? Mm-hmm. And the comments actually come up quicker. But I'm here and I'll be talking and it's just me. And over here, I'm just seeing these hands go. I'm like, I'm not, fuck, that's like 5 seconds ago.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that you brought up them because, yeah, I think they do a wonderful show. And again, you guys do a wonderful job too. YouTube is hard.
Yeah. And it's the boys, Aaron, so Ronnie Trickshot on Insta, and Adam, which is Shark Eyes, Levine. They've had to deal with my roller coaster of emotions of raising this channel over the past year and a half or something. And it is, if you don't have a YouTube channel and you're thinking of starting one, like, I would suggest you make sure that your mental capacity is in check first, because it is just like, woo, yeah,
especially early on.
Yeah. Yeah. First 150 subs or 150 videos, either one you pick, it's horrible. Like, you'll literally do a video and then you'll get, you know, 10 views and you'll be like, what am I doing wrong?
And sometimes you're doing nothing wrong.
Yeah, that's right. Just,
you're not in the algorithm yet.
Yeah.
You know, and if I do a G.I. Joe video, it does pretty well, almost always. Mm. I'm in the algorithm. Then I do another video, and it's like, it hits 100 views, and you're going,
yeah,
just by numbers, I should have more than 100 views.
Yeah.
But for some odd reason, I didn't put G.I. Joe in the title, so it didn't go out.
Yeah.
Yet I've done stuff like this in the past that's done well. But it is weird. And again, I always say people don't see how much time we spend in this chair behind
us. Yeah.
And they don't care either. It's really none of their business. No, but they also, in my opinion, people need to know. They need to understand, like, hey, we put a lot of effort into this.
Yeah.
So sometimes maybe cut some people some slack. Like you, I wouldn't say cut me slack because I'm an asshole. All right.
Like, you brought up those conversations on when old mate was having a go at you about accepting money from Patreon and stuff. I was sitting here yelling like the lady off Real Housewives or whatever. Just like, mate, if you don't have a YouTube channel, you don't understand the work.
Well, you know,
and
that
the resources. And everything that has to go towards a video.
Do you know who that was?
Yeah. Okay. But, you know, like, guaranteed there will be people out there with that same view saying, why are you accepting money? Well, because it's a nice way to support someone who's doing something for you.
Yeah, and again, I appreciate that. And again, I'm not demanding money. It's not like the show's gotten popular.
Yeah.
I'd be lying if I said I didn't notice that. If I said, hey, you know what? Listen, I know you guys really like this, but now my Monday nights, their lives are only going to be for members only. So if you want to watch me, you got to pay for it.
Yeah.
That shit's slimy.
Yeah, that gets to me when I see members only things pop up in my YouTube thing for other channels. I'm like, oh, so I can't watch it. Well, why would I support you then? Like,
but at the same time, I do that to give back something to the channel members for them.
Oh, but that's a reward. Yes. Like, you give so much content just in general anyway. Like, you make so much that I don't feel left out. All right. But there's some channels out there that it's like half-half, and you're like,
now, I'm not going to pat myself on the back, but yeah, I do a lot of content.
Well, that's the best thing, right? Like, when I say, and we all know you don't mind a bit of a chat for a long video, but on the other side of that, that's also 3 to 5 to 8 hours of time that is yours that you're giving us. So, you know, it's not a negative. It's actually a positive. You're giving us your time. So, yeah.
And you know, it is appreciative when people realize that.
Hmm.
And again, I tell everyone, hey, just the best way to support the channel, hit that like button and hit the subscribe button.
Yeah.
Because that's how YouTube puts it out more.
Yeah.
And then I can get the suckers that will send me the big super chats.
That's right. Like my $2 super chats I always give you.
No matter what it is, I definitely appreciate it. I always do. Because, again, everything goes back right into what I'm doing. You know, there's not many toy tubers that are making a living off of this.
No.
Dan
it's
Larson,
all a labor of love.
Yeah, Dan Larson, Shardimus Prime, Pixel Dan. I think they're probably the only ones.
Right.
You know, and so I appreciate anyone because, like, I mean, you say I'm giving you, you know, my time. Mm-hmm. I look at it like you are donating your hard-earned money for something that you enjoy. You don't have to do it. And like I said, when I decide to go, hey, my Monday nights are only for channel members. That's when you become like, all right, this, you know, it's time that you give me some money. All right. Like,
yeah, it's all choices.
Yeah. But I can tell you, not many people agreed with that sentiment.
Okay.
Not your sentiment. No, that sentiment of toy frustration.
Yeah.
When they came in, they're like, not many people agreed with that.
No.
Which was, I gotta say, very nice to see that people were saying what they were saying. So,
yeah,
it definitely made me.
And I don't even think that was a tribal thing, you know. I think he come in with a dumb, provocative statement and got the attention that he either seeked or deserved.
Yeah.
Hmm.
And I had seen it, and I didn't realize people were really addressing it that much. And then you notice and you're like, oh boy, it ain't going the way he thought.
It was enough that, like, cause I didn't catch that broadcast and old Shark Eyes Levine ended up telling me about it in our chat. And he was like, man, some douche come in and started having a go at Punk today about money and blah. And I'm like, man, I gotta go watch that.
Shark Eyes Levine. And if you're still watching and you've been wondering what the hell was that thumbnail about, you got it. Shark Eyes Levine.
Yeah. Punk interviewed Shark Eyes one day, and because, you know, we're such good mates and we like to shit stir each other, I put a note in the comments saying, hey, Punk, ask Shark Eyes about his Avril Lavigne shirt. And, yeah, that was too much. Like, it was very funny to watch.
And oddly enough, it hasn't gone away.
No. Because there's, you know, that shit stirrer guy sitting in the background just bringing it up each time.
Oh, which I absolutely love. Tell everyone where they can find you on Instagram, YouTube, anywhere else.
Yep. So if you just look for this name here on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube, that's it. I don't do any of the other socials. My Instagram presence is pretty much just a way of just chucking out occasional photos. They're nothing special, just celebrating, altering all things toys. YouTube is my way of getting to open up brand new toys and show you what it's like. I wouldn't really call them reviews. They're more just, I'm going to crack them open anyway, and I'd like to share that with you. And also our Tuesday night lives is the ones to tune into. So that's where Adam and Aaron, so Shark Eyes and Ronnie Trickshot and myself, we sit down and we just talk something about Joe's once a week. And that's our, selfishly, our catch up with each other.
But your Tuesday night is our Tuesday morning.
Monday morning, early Monday morning, I think.
Is it?
I think so. A lot of the time, I know podcasts from the pit has said that they have a lot of trouble doing it because it's like 4 a.m. where they are.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
But yeah, if you can definitely be part of the replay squad and let us know what you think. We're just three Aussies that like talking shit about G.I. Joe.
And I will post links to both his Instagram and YouTube in the description. So please go over there, hit that like button, hit the subscribe button for them, because Lenny is, as you can tell, it's been 2.5 hours. And had an absolute great time here.
Yeah, it's great.
So, but we are going to wrap it up. Thank you so much for joining.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Hey, always, man. So much fun. And we got to do more lives together.
Yeah.
Even though we're like 13 or 14 hours apart.
We can make it work.
I don't sleep. It doesn't matter. All right, guys. Thank you very much for tuning in. Hit that like button, hit that subscribe button, and then go do the same thing for Frostbite, G.I. Joe, Repro. Take care. I'm looking for the outro. Here we go.